So I'm Michael Franceschi, the name says it on the bottom there. I started, everyone sort of has a meandering career, how they get to Disney. I don't know if we talked about how at Disney we have the sort of featured artist thing, where everyone talks about their journey, but it always comes from everyone's different.
Sure.
Mine started, I went to school, I'll just go that far back.
Sure.
I did my undergraduate in illustration. Actually started off at the Mass College of Art in Boston. And then really got into illustration, history of illustration. So I started researching schools that on the East Coast that were really had really good programs in that. So I ended up going to Syracuse University for illustration. It was like all guys that were like book illustrators, editorial illustrators back in the 60s and 70s when there was a boom of that sort of industry.
Yeah, yeah.
Like illustration comparatively, like out here was much more tailored to production and stuff like that. And so initially I wanted to do background design. And because I painted, I was an oil painter.
Damn.
And I was quickly sort of diverted into the sort of freelance realm. And after I graduated, I moved to the city. I was like pounding the pavement, trying to get, you know, some work in illustration. I ended up making connections to get a job at the Society of Illustrators in New York. It's on the Upper East Side. And the cool thing about that place is I didn't do illustration all day, but like I met every day. I interacted with everybody that was in that field. It was there that I made friends with like Peter DeSev, who I'm sure a lot of you know as a character designer for animation, and a man named Willis Pyle. So I was just kind of like, at that point I was like, I don't know if I want to, like, I'm seeing like the successful illustrators really like waiting by the phone. I didn't know if I wanted to deal with that for my life.
Sure.
The rest of my life. So it's like, you know, it started reigniting my passion in animation. So I met this guy named Willis Pyle, who was an animator at Disney during Pinocchio and those sort of like golden age.
Right.
He was an elderly man at the time and living in the Upper West Side. Ended up just moving into illustration, doing his own thing.
Sure.
I think he had a beautiful thing going on in the Upper West Side where he had rent control. So he'd been there for like 60 years. He probably paid like $2 a month for this like,
I'm sure,
wraparound balcony apartment.
Yeah.
So anyway, like he's like getting contact. Sorry, this is a long sort of story.
Take your time.
But he's like getting contact with my friend Jules Engel, who he worked for at the UPA. So he had some great stories about, you know, working on the first incarnation of UPA with Gerald McBoing-Boing and moving on to Mr. Magoo. So he left Disney, I think, after Fantasia, maybe.
Oh, okay.
And he's like, talk to Jules Engel. He was down in, he was the grad program chair at USC.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So I got a hold of him and I was like, yeah, I think grad school is the way to go. I want to go to school for animation. So I started playing around. Realized that program was more experimental. So gotcha. I didn't want to just make films and then struggle the same way I would have as an illustrator. So I ended up my wife and I, well, we weren't married at the time, but went out to San Francisco to check out the Academy of Art. And more than falling in love with the Academy of Art, we fell in love with the Bay Area.
Sure.
Ended up moving up there and going to grad school for a few years. And so I have my fair share of like knowledge of brick and mortar schools. So ask me any questions about that and I'll give you my opinion. So after I finished at the Academy, I threw out my website. I didn't really apply anywhere. I just wanted to put feelers out because I was still working on my reel and stuff.
Yeah.
But my reel had, or like my website had both my illustration stuff, or my old stuff, and some animation tests and pieces of my short film.
Sure.
And I had a friend at Weta in New Zealand. He was a modeler because he was one of the instructors at the Academy. And then I also had a contact, some guy at Nickelodeon that I never met. So I just emailed them both and I got a response from both.
Wow.
New Zealand was a lot slower. At first, I'm like, the prospect of moving out there seemed amazing. And he's like, I can't talk about the project, but
sure,
it's actually the first Avatar,
mm-hmm.
which would have been the project. And then Nickelodeon was just like, we want you now, come down.
Wow.
I'm like, well, can I look at the studio first? Can I, I don't know if I want to move to LA.
Yeah, yeah.
So we took a road trip. And I toured the studio, which is awesome because it's like a blast from your childhood, you know,
sure.
Rugrats and like Ren and Stimpy all over mm-hmm. the wall, the super colorful building. I'm like, yeah, cartoons is the way for me.
For sure.
I made sort of like decision right there that I don't think whatever, you know, even if it's like an amazing, at the time, like they were doing Lord of the Rings stuff. So it's like, that would be cool, but that's a different direction. And that's not sort of like what I was into.
Sure.
So I made the decision to go to Nickelodeon. So there for 4.5 years, I think, almost five.
Okay.
I started as an animator working on some shows that they were developing. They had this small group called the Core Development Team.
Okay.
And what they would do is we would just kind of float between new shows, do pilots, do tests for ideas that were getting floated around the studio.
Sure.
And my first thing was this terrible show. Sorry, what's going on in the world, but it was terrible. It was called Pack and the Power of Juju. And I think it was based on a video game that they got the rights to.
Okay.
Funny enough, I think Hiram worked on this.
Oh, did
he? Okay. He animated on it. Because I walked in his office one day and he had this, one of the characters was like Jabulba or something. I forget what the hell their name was, but
okay.
Weird character. I'm like, why do you have this bobblehead? And he's like, I worked on it. So,
oh, wow.
Anyway, so like with that, the being there, they had a partnership with the sister company or the parent company was Paramount. So they had a partnership with DreamWorks. So we're doing some of their, like adapting some of their movies, which was always a challenge because you're like, it's never going to look as good, you know, like if you're trying to do a TV version of anyway.
Yeah.
What I found it like really interesting and exciting about it at the time was the original properties that we got. We got one called Fanboy and Chum Chum and Robot and Monster. And then the new incarnation when they got the rights to Ninja Turtles.
Oh, I see.
So we were able to like develop tests and stuff for that and really sort of sell like what it was going to be to the studio. And then I quickly moved into an animation supervisor position there. So I led a small internal team. Kim Hazel was on that team. and that's how we met.
I see.
And we would start a project and then, you know, it would get handed off to the vendor studios. We had some in Vancouver, Taiwan, Taipei, Seoul, and New Zealand.
Wow.
So what was cool about that position for me was able to like, go over and like train the teams on the animation style if it was different.
Sure.
And then sort of get the show going, but then it was like ripped away from us and then we were on to the next. So it was like perpetual pre-production.
Gotcha.
and then I just got sort of tired of the pre-production. I wanted to see a project from start to finish and I always wanted to be at Disney. So I was like, I'll make a leap. And I applied over at Disney during Wreck-It Ralph.
Oh, okay.
And started in January 2012.
Okay.
Beginning, was intimidated because I was the only person that was there that came from TV. but it was like in that fear, I just worked my ass off.
I'm sure.
And I just wanted to stay. And by the end, like I was asked to be a supervisor on Big Hero 6.
It's awesome.
So I left Frozen early, the first Frozen. And then moved on to pre-production on Big Hero 6. I left pre-production to go back into
I know, right?
but that was a cool experience. I felt it over my head because, you know, I just kind of got there. Worked on, after that, Moana and Zootopia, Inner Workings. I led Olaf on the Olaf's Frozen Adventure that the world loved.
Right.
I'm being very facetious there.
Sure, sure.
Would have never put it in front of Coco.
Anyway. I know. Yeah.
And now here we are. I think we know the list of movies, and now I'm on Raya and the Last Dragon.
Awesome. Yeah, you had a crazy journey. There are things I didn't know, like how you got to Nickelodeon and everything. That's awesome.
Yeah, that was. I mean, those. I'll be sure to share this with anybody. A lot of times, it's like timing and knowing somebody. You know, like
sure.
It's or not. I mean, like talent brings you just so far, and then it just like timing. I feel like is mm-hmm. everything. Like Nickelodeon didn't need someone at that moment. They hadn't had any animators in house.
Hmm.
So me coming in being the first one, I remember everyone being so pissed off at this guy because all they wanted to do was animate. And they were doing like other things, like being, there's like generalists and stuff that were brought in.
Sure.
And they're like, who's this asshole? It's just animating. Like, why can't we do that? That's what we would, you know?
Yeah. Anyway, yeah.
It was like just the right pocket and the timing. And I think Kim could probably attest to it. Like when we were there, I tried to carve out this thing where we were doing stuff for the studio, but we weren't doing stuff for the show other than like main titles and interstitials and that kind of stuff. But like we were doing our own tests to like bulk up our own reels in a way. Like we're doing character performance tests. I'm like, hey, you know, go through, pick a shot that you want to do.
Right.
You could find that character. And it was like a cool opportunity to, even though the rigs were limited,
right,
to do some like, you know, your own stuff to like further your experience outside.
For sure. Awesome. All right. So with that said, I mean, we can pull up your reel here real quick. You had that pulled up on your side?
I do, yeah.
Okay. So
the long reel, you said?
It's the long reel, yeah.
Okay.
So we can just...
I changed my mind after this and I cut together the other...
Oh, they're like four.
Yeah, the other four.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, so this is a shortened version. So in case anyone else was interested in his full reel, you can check our website and it has all his reels. But at least here you have snippets that you can talk about. But yeah, I mean, I guess we can just play it, let people watch. And then if any questions come up from the chat specifically, if not, I have questions I've written down. So let's play it. Not coming!
Going the opposite direction.
Hi. Growing up means adapting. Puzzling out your world and your place.
When I'm more mature, I'll feel totally secure.
Being watched by something with a creepy, creepy face.
Your family and right sons. I will help you find the otter. I will take your kindness and pay it forward.
I found 130 results for Where Does My High School Girlfriend Live Now? You're welcome.
Mr. Nosemore!
Oh, delightful. You're that courteous little cherub who says please and thank you. What can Nosemore help you find? To the search bar, madam. I hope you were able to find a satisfactory breakfast burrito based upon the search results I provided this morning. What can Nosemore help you find now?
Hey, Olaf, maybe just one of you should do it.
I agree. She's a little pitchy.
Hey, Gil's back. Slam! Door shutting everywhere! Sisters torn apart!
Well, at least they have their parents. Their parents are dead.
What's this?
Are you okay?
I'm flirting? Wait, no, that's not it. I'm flirting away. I don't think Elsa's okay.
She may have gone too far.
I'm sorry. You're gonna have to do this next part on your own. Okay?
Wait.
And we're just hoping a few more of you will open your doors and your hearts to those in need.
Well,
I suppose that large green olive will fit in nicely with my decor.
I'm a sour ball.
Well, bakers can't be choosers, can they? Come along, condiment.
Okay.
Well, I remember
it was long ago, they would ring the bell.
Night howlers aren't wolves. They're toxic flowers. I think someone is targeting predators on purpose and making them go savage.
Wow. Isn't that interesting? Eat my new nose? Why would I do that?
Because it's that time of year.
It's that time of year!
Again!
Cool.
No, I'm coming!
Okay, word of advice, don't cut a reel that is like that. No, but I gave it to, this is for backstory, I gave it to Sean because I knew he was going to cut it up in different ways, but the flow is so bad. Anyway.
There is so much to go over. It's just impossible to show everything within like such a short time. You've done so much work.
Yeah, that's why I ended up separating it out. I was like, like to show chunks of 2018 to now, like right, and then just my favorite stuff from the past.
For sure. Yeah, no, that makes sense. I think within the reel, I think Chad asked about the test of Aunt Cass. Like,
oh yeah.
How much of he was asking how much of acting and personalities are kind of given to you, especially during like pre-production, and how much did you come up with like in her performance?
Yeah. So as a supervisor on that show, you end up meeting with the directors and writers and board artists that are sort of right at the beginning of production, and we kind of like just talk about who the character is and just really get into like, it's a full conversation about just one specific character. And in this case, it was Cass. And I don't know how much of this was revealed in other ways, but originally Cass was the mom. So I had developed her as the mom for a long time, Mama Cass. Huh. And she was always in charge of the coffee shop, so that didn't change. And she was always sort of like split, like she didn't have, the dad wasn't in the picture, what have you. So I did know like that they wanted her spunky, they wanted her multitasking, like spread thin, but a lot of energy. Sure. And I think I remember like some of the early designs, that's like how she sort of dresses. And like, I thought her design was really nice. They put a tattoo on her arm and sort of made her like look like the hip aunt. But at this point, when we were doing these tests, the head of animation, Zach Parrish, came up with this great idea of doing a constant. Basically everyone that had a character, the rigs were in at different stages. I think this is the early rig of Cass. There's cloth and hair is all messed up. Her face changed from this point. Mm-hmm. But just to like, here's a coffee shop character. This is Cass's coffee shop. Enter the door and what they do just to sit down. Like the assignment was walks in the door, sits down. Mm-hmm. So that's it. And basically go off and try to say as much about the character in a natural way that you can within that constraint. And I think that's a really great test for students to do.
Sure.
This one is kind of like the right length for a test, I would think.
Mm-hmm.
And all of them, like all the soups did things around this length. And it was really cool when we compiled them all together to just see the cast. It was an easy thing to pitch to the directors. At this time, Lasser was in the studio. He loved them.
Mm-hmm.
Other tests that we did with this was also we took our characters as spheres. We had to represent them as spheres and have them walk.
Interesting.
Like create, you know, a walk cycle essentially with a sphere. So it was just sort of like rhythm.
Huh.
So like Fred had this like zigzag. Like it was really cool to see that all come together. But specifically with Cass, a lot of it's left to us to explore.
Mm-hmm.
As much as we have. Okay, thank you. Can you close the door, dude? Sorry, my kids might interrupt me.
It's fine.
It's fine. Left, like, depending on how much time we have to develop this, because as you know, we know the story changes a lot things could shift. So you're kind of just working with whatever rig you have and doing as many character tests as you can to get the crew ready.
Right.
During the time as well, we're doing pose pages that sort of help keep the character on model and define the character. I'm kind of going off the question, but.
Oh, that's fine.
So yeah, it's like, it's very much a collaboration with the directors and the rest of the team of who establishes or like who the character is.
Gotcha.
And then, you know, if you're so fortunate, you can have the voice actor come in and sort of talk to you and give their thoughts about the character. At this point, Maya Rudolph did come in and talk to us.
I see.
She came into our office. She lost an earring or something in her couch. And we had to like embarrassingly pull out the couch, like dust bunnies and everything. Back.
Sure.
It was just, anyway, it was really fun.
Yeah.
She actually posed for, I created this, Kim will probably remember. We created this, I had a Polaroid camera and I just wanted to create the number 6 throughout production and with individual photos of the team throughout the experience.
Yeah.
I don't know. I have to find that picture somewhere, but she posed for one, which was really
cool. That's cool.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So on top of that, can you describe more in detail of like how you approach Baymax? So, you know, we talked about how, you know, with these characters, you're kind of given like, you know, their backstory and also like maybe their limitations. And I think that rings true, especially for Baymax, because, you know, he's such like a big shape. There isn't much flexible limbs per se. You know, he just kind of moves as an overall shape. So like, how'd you like approach that and explore it and also like try to find appeal in like the movement or the posing maybe within Baymax, because he's such a limited character in the sense of there isn't too much you can do.
True. So first we started off by meeting with robotics experts and specifically in the like the emerging technology, because a lot of them were talking about how the current application is in nurse bots and helping, you know, assisted living and that kind of thing. So we talked about like what they would look like and what they do. We looked at a bunch of different ways they moved. A lot of them were really creepy and it actually informed the design of Baymax too. Like a lot of them look scary. So
sure.
I think Shiyun found the design of Baymax's face in a bell in Korea, perhaps, like just walking down the street. And so after we sort of learned about the sort of science behind the robotics and stuff, we talked about how should he move? Like how much flexibility should he have? I mean, he's a blown up balloon.
Right.
So how should it work? Am I paused? Did something happen here?
No, you're good.
Okay. My daughter. Both kids come and tell me. a lot of what we came to is very like purposeful movement. And that meant like where the exploration came in is like what leads what. You know, would he, you know, tilt his head first to do like to present a thought, Was it a blink? What? It was really going down, exploring these limited movements in different orders, finding different phrasings of it. Like, so it would be like, you know, did he tilt his head and then do the, would he and then wave? Uh-huh. Or would he, you know, wave and then, so it was like just kind of working within a narrow parameter.
Sure.
And exploring different timing and phrasing techniques within that.
Gotcha.
It really helped to have someone like, I know Miner came on really early, one of our talented animators at the time, and he did an inflatable test, and it really helped define a lot. So, I mean, it's not only on the, obviously on the leadership to define these things, it's really the, once it's shelled out to the crew, they just pick up the mantle or take the lead on everything.
Sure.
And there was a lot of times there's too much to test. So you can't really do it all yourself.
Sure.
And then when it came to Baymax Super, which I really concentrated a lot of my efforts on, it was like, well, how do we represent this inflatable limited robot inside this badass mechanized suit?
Right.
And because you want to, like, our first incarnation and some of the tests you'll see in my reel is like, he's kind of walking with, you know, the heaviness and people weren't really responding to that. And it's like, well, if he's still Baymax under there, let's try what we, how we approached him in the vinyl form.
Right.
That was to make him sort of walk and act like a baby penguin. That was a lot of the sort of inspiration of his locomotion style was baby penguins.
Sure.
So we sort of like pushed that into the Baymax Super suit. Aside from, like, you know, as he's fighting yokai and all that kind of stuff and flying in the air.
Sure.
But yeah, it's really just a lot of exploration and a lot of saying, nah, that doesn't look right. No, that doesn't look right. Gotcha. And then you keep, you know, exploring as you know.
Sure. Sure. Okay, cool. Let's see.
He went through a big redesign too, I gotta say. That's kind of a fun story where he was done. He was rigged.
Okay.
I'm talking Baymax Super.
Uh-huh.
And then Lasseter ended up showing it to a friend, and like he had some designer in automotive industry somewhere.
Okay.
I forget which company, but they're like, no, he needs to be more sleek. So it was sort of like going from Iron Man, like Mach 1.
Yeah, yeah.
to like a sleeker sort of BMW version of.
Interesting. Okay.
So we, you know, I had to learn all about like aerodynamics and stuff like that, and like understanding the wing structure and camber and.
Huh.
It's fun.
That's awesome. Interesting. So going off of that, since you have, like, as we talked about, just like all the stuff that you've done, but you have like so much variety in your work, from like. From something really subtle to like really push / cartoony, I guess to get more specific, it's like, you know, like someone asked about Olaf. It's like, you know, like how do you push like your choices, but also try to stay within the limitation without going too overboard, and you know, how do you tackle between like, let's say, like a subtle Olaf versus like a high energy Olaf, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
How do you sell the appeal in both?
So yeah, that's an interesting question. I mean, I always gravitate to the broader stuff, but, I really enjoyed doing the subtle work on Olaf on Frozen 2 this time around. And then it just, cause I understood that character really well from having worked on him on, I think I might be one of the, this is not bragging. Those of you that know me, they know the difference. Every Frozen property. That has been made by the studio. So I understood the character.
Sure.
And it was really just trying to find, like, what was always communicated to us is this sort of idea of truth and materials, and not to like forget what he's made of, and that, you know, there's rules that we make up for this character. And when Hiram sort of was in charge of developing him in the first Frozen, they decided, like, don't bend his arms and don't do much too much squash and stretch with him, because they want to make it still feel like that's a stick and this is snow. So I mean, of course there's push and pull within that
range,
And a lot of us have really tested that.
Sure.
The vignettes really tested that.
Yep.
he bent his arms.
Yeah, yeah.
So, a lot of it's like understanding the material you're working with and mm-hmm. sort of finding the sweet zone within that. And for me, with the subtle stuff, specifically with Olaf, it was really finding how much mush I can get away with in the face. That was a really fun experiment for me to see how much flexibility I can have without making him feel too staccato.
Right.
And not too much that it would feel too much like a marshmallow.
Right.
But yeah, I think that's the fun. It's just trying to find, to discover those limitations while you're doing it. And if you have time to experiment, but.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Then with that said, like how we talked about, you know, exploring characters and trying to get specific with the character choices, like do you have any like tips or suggestions, especially for students who are like, you know, they're always starting with a blank canvas, maybe with a rig that's already, you know, been used like hundreds and millions of times by other students as well. Like how would you recommend a student to like go beyond what's given to them? For like exercises and whatnot, and kind of like what you did with on cast. So yeah, any advice?
Yeah, so, and I mean, as you're probably well aware, like ideas are the things that really get you hired. Mm-hmm. And specifically at the studio, they're looking for that like nuance and that specificity in right. the animation tests, like not so much that a character moves well, it's more so like what's kind of behind it.
Right.
And how I would approach it is sort of, and I was reviewing someone's reel the other day actually, and gave him this tip because everything moved well, but it was just moving well. Mm. It didn't necessarily have a purpose.
Right.
And I was like, I think what you could do is sort of like set up the scenario that you have, two character dialogue test or something, and you sure. have a clip that you're using from some movie that hopefully no one recognizes. And then you got to create a backstory with them.
Right.
You don't have to show it in the movie, but like really sit down and like write it out. I'd say like write out a page of like where these characters are coming from, because in a movie this is meant to be like a sliver of a longer moment. Right. Mm-hmm. And in films, like we have the ability and the advantage of like already having that done for us.
Right.
So like generate sort of a list or a summary of each of the characters, where they're coming from, what the temperature outside, just like create a list of things that could make the situation more specific.
Right. Gotcha.
How are they feeling before this? Like, how are they feeling now? Are they really saying what they feel in the dialogue track, or can it be interesting to sort of turn it on its head and play some contrast on it?
Right.
So I think that's it. I understand, like, I was in the same boat where you kind of like, you're using the same rigs that have been floating around for a while.
Mm-hmm.
I remember hearing at the time when I was applying to schools, there was a character called Gennari. I don't know if Gennari. You remember this.
Not sure.
It was like this little blue guy with big eyes.
Oh, okay. I might have known. Yeah.
And like, I was hearing, you hear things through the grapevine, and I heard that, like, no one wants to see Gennari in anybody's reel anymore. I'm like, well. Like what are we supposed to do?
Yeah, I know, right?
So yeah, it's really, trying to eke out something specific out of it. I know it's easier said than done, but like,
sure,
it's kind of working backwards.
Yeah. No, that makes sense. That's what I try to like tell students too. It's like just being more specific versus trying to make something move in a nice arc, or because I feel like a lot of times students focus so much on the execution of animation versus like the foundation of it. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I think it helps when a professional like keeps reiterating like what's important in a reel.
Yeah, totally.
So with that said, like I'm sure you've been in review rooms and stuff for hiring. So are there like type of students, interns, trainees who have applied that either surprised you or impressed you with their like either their work, and once they did get there, what kind of attitude like that you like seeing from them, so that kind of students can see what, I don't know, how they should behave basically.
Yeah. Yeah. Work ethics. Yeah. First, I think I've been in a a lot of like the rooms always change based on the people that are in them.
Mm-hmm.
But early on, I really liked John Carr's in the review rooms with us, because he would be able to see the spark. And this is something that I hope we do more.
Hmm.
You see a spark in an animator's ideas more than sort of the polish behind it all.
For sure.
Marat was as we know, was one of these guys. Like his reel wasn't super polished, but he had some crazy cool ideas, things you haven't seen. Because typically, and I think what students have going for them right now is there ends up being vogues and waves within the hiring mechanism.
Hmm.
And that is, occasionally you run into reels that you've seen over and over again, in
right.
terms of, like, during Big Hero 6, Hotel T came out, and it was just sort of like all of those reels coming in, and you didn't know how long it took someone, how much Gendy was involved, like, mm-hmm. not to pick on that because it was really cool animation, but like,
sure.
you didn't know how they got there with that. So when we would see a reel come in with an actual, a professional reel with like some tests coupled in there,
mm-hmm.
it would tell us more about the animator and it would shine.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like sort of refreshing to see some reels that had just had tests on it.
Mm.
So I think the things that sort of stand out in the noise, and again, like, you know, work experience is work experience, but to really show who you are as an artist, as an animator, as a storyteller, if you could exhibit that in your reel, that's the things that get noticed.
Mm-hmm.
Those unique performances get noticed. The things that, like, if the character really feels like there's something going on behind the eyes, if there's subtext,
mm-hmm.
that gets noticed. But, you know, a character just sort of standing there talking like, you know, moving their hands and, you know, moving well, but like it doesn't really stand out.
Mm-hmm.
And again, everything changes. I don't think I would get hired with the reel that I had going in.
Sure.
And that's because people get more, like, the talent has increased, and sure. also based on the project. Like, I came in on Wreck-It Ralph because I worked on a variety of animation styles. So Wreck-It Ralph had a variety of animation styles within it. So it kind of, it matched. So I don't know if I would have been hired if Frozen was the next one.
Sure.
Without any of that kind of stuff on my reel. So,
yeah.
Was there a follow-up to that question?
Like, so once they do get in, is there like a type of personality trait or, you know, their behavior or whatnot that surprised you in a good way or a bad way, that you wish you would see more from students that's coming in?
Well, I mean, I always love seeing the hunger, and the excitement, you know, of the students coming in. I think humility is a big part, like a big piece that I sort of respect.
Sure.
Sort of like, I mean, animation isn't a place to sort of be braggadocious and sort of be that type of personality.
Right.
I think sort of learning from the people around you when you first enter a studio is really well received.
Hmm.
Showing them the sort of respect that it took for them to get there. I think that really goes a long way.
For sure.
It just helps you to be a more grounded individual and just like, just be a good person, you know?
Sure.
Just be a good person.
Yeah, yeah.
And yeah, like, take notes from anybody, you know? If, like, there's a lot of people that kind of bristle at notes. Like, you get, you know, we as artists get attached and put a lot of our self-worth behind our work.
Mm-hmm.
into our work. So, you know, sometimes notes can be hard to hear because you're it's like almost like you're insulting them. But
mm-hmm.
a lot of folks who've gone through art school or have been through critiques understand that it's not the individual that you're poking at, you're kind of trying to find the best idea.
Right.
So being able to be receiving that feedback
mm.
is a really important piece of the equation.
Gotcha.
For someone coming in and being successful, I think.
Right. Okay. And going off of that, like, having been a supervisor, and I know Boris asked about, like, you know, what are the things that made you a better animator, but also on top of that, like, are there any things that you've learned, you know, like, as a supervisor, like, like type of like leadership that is needed. That makes up a good leader, and that could also be applied just as an employee, although you're not necessarily a leader, but things that you've experienced that you think you could shine a light on.
Yeah, I think the best thing was it really taught me how to show. Okay, what I enjoyed about working and collaborating on the leadership side is when I saw someone, you know, being very communicative and being very gracious about receiving notes, like I'm always know where the shot is, or that there was just a certain degree of professionalism that you get a glimpse at, like how people work in different ways and how they communicate in different ways. And I really sort of in my experience at Disney, more so than my experience at Nickelodeon, because I had, you know, there is that difference of ebbing and flowing out of leadership at Disney, that it really, when I got back on the floor, made me much more diligent about communicating effectively and politely to production, you know, production coordinators and PAs.
Sure.
Like having them know exactly where you are in your shot and project when you're going to show. Like I'm very communicative in terms of like, I'm going to show in rounds this time. I'm going to show in dailies right after, you know, like keeping that constant dialogue is so appreciated on the other side that a lot of people don't necessarily know, because a lot of people get a shot and they just sort of like go hibernate for a while.
Right.
And then you're like, what's going on? You know, and then, you know, it's like sort of protective of what they're doing. It's not ready to be seen.
Yeah.
You know, I think showing early helps. Not cooking things for too long.
Right.
You know, yeah. And then really understanding, you know, as a supervisor, understanding that there are different ways that people work, and you're going to have to sort of train your eye and being able to respond and give helpful feedback to different workflows.
Gotcha. Makes sense. And I guess getting more specific, because students love hearing about workflows. So I know we talked about subtle and cartoony shots. Does your workflow change when you get specific type of shots, like let's say super cartoony like Olaf versus something more subtle? Do you tackle them differently, and in what ways?
Yeah, I do. I feel like I go into every shot in a different way.
Sure.
I try to get the spline as quickly as humanly possible. Sometimes I think in the last few years I just start in spline. I just shoot it out on twos and fours and whatever.
Sure.
But in terms of like something like Nose More and you know, the inner working stuff, which was some of my most favorite stuff that I've worked on. I end up blocking those out on steps, because it's really about the poses in that case.
Right.
Even broad Olaf stuff, I'll block out steps. But then I try to get the spline as quickly as possible, because I think Amanda probably said this, like, I don't want to redo it. want to go back and get a surprise.
Yeah.
So I try to get out of it as soon as possible. For the subtle stuff, it's always spline. I never step it. Like I'm working on some subtle stuff now, and I can't see it like that, because my brain will slip into illustrator mode and then like get married to poses too much. I might like put some key poses in there first to get the general idea.
Yeah.
No one will ever see that, and then I'll get out of it as soon as humanly possible.
Interesting. So do you like, if you leave it on spline for like subtle stuff, then do you like take like one main control and kind of animate within that, or how do you go about it?
I kind of keep myself limited in that way. Like I try to get the pose I need with the controls necessary.
Gotcha.
But I will limit myself, like in terms of body. Like I'll start with hips and upper chest head control first, and get a general like rhythm to it in that way.
Sure.
And then I'll try to get to the face as quickly as possible, because that's I have the most fun with that. Like lip sync is one of my most favorite things to work on. So I try to get that stuff in there, because it helps me as soon as I can get from zero to something, it really helps me see the shot more and the more I'm living in it.
Sure.
So if I start working on, like sometimes I'll, like for the Olaf stuff, I'll have him in a single pose and then I'll animate the dialogue and the facial and then I'll like support it.
Oh, I see.
And I'll sometimes do that with like mid shots. Like if depending on if I shot reference or not, or how much reference I'm actually using in the shot. Like, again, that's like a completely different way I work, but like it, like living in there and doing like the expressions and working with the mouth. And like, sometimes I understand the shot more than I would if I just got up and acted it out.
I see. Gotcha. Yeah. I think someone actually asked in the chat about lip sync, like, do you have any tips for it? Cause I think lip sync is one of the most challenging things for students, especially, because it's so much easier to do something broad, like body action, versus something lip sync related where it's a very crafted, like posing wise especially. So okay. Do you have any tips for that?
I feel the opposite. I think like,
oh really?
I like, there's something about just getting in there, and it, I think it's maybe my like oil painting background when I do this like fastidious like detailed oil painting and whatever, and I want to get to the details quick. But no, I think what helps is starting, I mean, I don't know if a lot of people do this, like they start with the up, down, the bigger movements, the in out. But I'll like straight ahead it a lot of times.
Sure.
Like typically, I know that's not a tip, but like I'll like find similar shapes within the dialogue too, so I don't have to recreate them along the way.
Right.
Like, I don't know if that's obvious, but like I'll, like if I use an open before, I'll use it again. It might not necessarily be the right open shape, but I'll craft it to make it work.
Gotcha.
And a lot of times, you know, as you know, like pose page helps a lot in terms of
for sure
with dialing things in and using a scale to get some shapes. But I mean, depending on what you're working with, a lot of times it might give you a pose or two, and then you have to work, you have to craft the rest yourself, obviously.
Right.
But I don't have any specific tips. Like, it's really like knowing, I always like, if there's a tongue, like I'll often have a tongue, and like there's a lot of characters I've worked with that had those sort of limitations, but really understanding, and I see this as an error in a lot of student work, and I'll see it in professional work as well, where the oohs, the wides and the narrows don't necessarily line up correctly. It's like understanding what shape came before it.
Interesting.
And how that previous shape informs the next shape.
Interesting.
So that's typically why I do it straight ahead, because if I just kind of plot it out like you would an exposure sheet,
sure,
in TV or what have you, it doesn't really work that way. And a lot of times you'll see where like the oohs and the ahs don't really work correctly.
Gotcha. And then it says in the chat, it says, if you can talk more about how you approach creating nice rhythm and texture in your shots.
Oh, I never thought that I did that. I think it's like, I typically try to get like a solid pass on the body quick, and then spline it, and then find ways of changing, making that interesting. Because early in my career, like when I was first learning, everything was so even. And I don't know if that's a common thing with students.
For sure.
But like I didn't really understand, even though like I've played music my whole life, I didn't understand how to apply that sort of phrasing and rhythm into a shot necessarily. And so it's really just finding ways of changing up lead and follow. I think rhythm is sort of like that undefinable piece of animation where it's informed by lead and follow and phrasing and timing. It's like, it's when a shot can sing and you don't really know why. And I think the lead and follow has something to do with it, where, you know, if a character is coming to a pose a certain way, like leave it in a different way, you know, like that was always like sort of like, oh, that's an immediate little trick that you can apply in any situation in your animation. It's like, if the hand comes in first, then have the hand lead, like, leave last, you know, at the next, just changing that up.
Right.
But for me, like, I try to find, I typically block my stuff out in like a 4/4 time, even if there's no rhythm, like music in it.
Right.
That might be something that's unique to me. I don't know, but like, I'll always block it out, in like a musical time in terms of like what a 4/4 like rhythm beat would be.
Sure.
And then I'll play within it within that.
Gotcha. Cool. Yeah, cause like, I think like one of the things that stood out to me, especially for like regarding rhythm and texture, was your Olaf shot from Frozen 2. I think it was this one. I don't know if you can see the screen.
Yeah.
So I was actually curious of like how, I think you shared it in an Instagram post and stuff, but like, what was your thought process behind like just when you were just given this, you know, like as a storyboard format of like, all right, just get Olaf dancing and singing, whatever, whatnot. How'd you go about like creating the rhythm in here? So yeah, I think it'd be interesting to kind of go over it.
So what's interesting about this shot is that there was no dancing in it.
Oh, really?
In the storyboard form, Dan Abraham, super talented dude, boarded this sequence and the Lost in the Woods sequence.
Mm.
Really, really funny guy. He just had Olaf walking from the background to the foreground.
Mm.
And the only sort of piece of information that I was given was he was dodging, you know, this boulder. And
right.
sort of oblivious to the things that were happening around him.
Mm-hmm.
And when I talked to Trent Corey, who was the animation supervisor for this, it's like, I think it's a cool opportunity to get fanciful with him and sort of bring in some old, like musical throwbacks. Like, I looked at like Easter Parade with Fred Astaire.
Mm.
He really interacts with his environment. Like, I tried to find musical numbers that the character was interacting with their environment.
Sure.
And of course, like Singing in the Rain, and that piece where he goes up around the tree was a very much
for
singing
sure.
in the rain moment.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I approached him like, okay, well, how can I do this? I had like, I think I asked Snow to like do some stuff for me too. I'm like, I wanted this thing where he's sort of skipping first.
Mm-hmm.
I had Darren Butters, another animator who's brilliant with acting, help out too. Because I'll always like do acting myself, and then I'll ask some other people to give me a take, and I'll pull pieces from it.
Sure.
So then I just like found little things where like, how do I make him sort of oblivious? So I, you know, I would just find different posing within that. And then I'm always working to that rhythm, obviously, because I get that for free with the track.
Sure.
And then just try to find ways of, I mean, again, the rhythm is there for like avoiding the boulder.
Right. Right.
The salamander.
Mm-hmm.
So I had those sort of cues as well to like have him look away.
Sure.
Have him jump out of the way. I met with Eric Goldberg before starting the shot too, and just to get his idea about, his sense of rhythm and phrasing is amazing, obviously.
Sure.
And he said that try to do those moments where he avoids the rock and Bruni on the downbeat, because that like gives you, like, he will always try to get like the comedic moment within there, or like that beat on the downbeat.
Hmm.
So then you continue on the regular rhythm.
Gotcha.
Afterward. It was a cool, like, I hadn't thought of that.
Interesting.
So, did that answer the question, or like?
Yeah, no, I think so. Let's see. And then I think, let's see, what can we talk about? So outside of that, I guess we can talk something more in a broader terms of like, as an artist, like what brings like, I don't know, like passion in your work, like what excites you? Because I think as an artist and even as a student, we can feel the burnout, you know, no matter what, whatever that may be. So what kind of like brings you back? Because like, you know, you hear so many stories of like, you know, either artists who decide not to pursue their craft anymore because they, you know, after years, they just kind of like lose their this touch of passion, and student-wise, and they also feel the same, where there's this, they don't necessarily feel like they're improving, or they just don't find that spark anymore. So have you ever felt that? And if so, like, how'd you kind of get yourself back into the game?
That definitely ebbs and flows. I don't know if you could relate with that. But like, I'll be inspired. I mean, I think maybe this is the natural way of being an artist, that I'll be inspired one day and then like hate it the next. But typically what brings me back is doing stuff that I really love outside. You know, if I'll do an illustration, or I'll be in my workshop here and do some wood carving and something that will like sort of draw the creative juices again, like, you know, stir it up and then try to get going on the animation. Typically when it comes specifically to animation, I really love, and I think there was a question early on in this chat, like, I gravitate towards smaller projects. Like, I love feeling a part of something, and I think we all kind of do, like having a bigger piece of the pie. I think that's why I liked the leadership stuff as well, is like, you feel like you're actually contributing. Or like, I get excited about projects where I can work on a specific character, like Nosemore was one, or like in Inner Workings, like that was a small team, so I felt like I was able to give a lot of myself in it. That was really inspiring. And, you know, like, the working with a director in that capacity, or a lead, is, and knowing that what you're putting forth is actually really valuable, that excites me a lot. So like, it's harder when you don't gravitate towards a specific character in a film.
For sure.
Like, fortunately, there's been a lot at the studio. I don't want to name my least favorite ones, but like, my most favorite ones are the ones that I was able to digest a lot of the character. Even though I have my qualms with Frozen 2, like, I was able to work 90%, 95% of the time with Olaf, which made me really happy. For Wreck-It Ralph, I was able to work with Nosemore, which was, I love UPA animation, so like, it really was trying to, like, it fit, you know. So again, if it's outside of animation, I try to find ways of inspiring myself with other people's work, or with doing something that's not animation.
Interesting. Gotcha. And going off of that, I feel like a lot of burnouts can come from time and time management. So what is your advice on time management? Not just, I guess you can also talk about time management with like handling your shots, because I think a lot of students who come into the industry, they kind of don't know exactly how much time they should spend on like each, you know, stages. And then also like time management, just juggling with work and also life. Like, how do you go about it?
I don't know how I go about it. I'm still trying to figure out a balanced life.
No. For sure.
And who knows what this is, this situation. It's been typically, like, in terms of, start with time management and your shots. I try to, like, plan it out for a couple days. You know, I don't want to, like, go too fast, but don't go too slow. So, like, getting my ideas in order first. Right. Might be the case. Like, sometimes I don't have a clue about how to animate a shot, so I have to get up and like act it out. And then like, I try to get something down, because I'll spin. Like, I have trouble being decisive with like even color and like choices in illustration and stuff. I have trouble, like, I'm like, I like this one too, but I also like this one. And so I'm the same way with animation ideas. And so I just try to like lay something out quick. And again, like, however I can get there, I might start with the face. You know, like I said before, it's like, I don't know. Maybe I'd have to lay something out, and I don't really have my mind around the shot, so I'll just start with the face. I think not getting hung up for too long really helps, you know, like starting to just get something out there, helps me for sure.
Gotcha.
In terms of management of life and and work. I don't know. Like, I'm in a paradigm right now where I have to educate my kids, and wife works, and she's an educator, and I have a job. So yeah. I don't know what my life is right now.
Sure.
But at the studio, when we were going to the studio, it was typically, man, I gotta say, like, I don't get, on a personal level, I don't really start getting going until after lunch. Like, I'm not a, like, work in the morning, get a lot of stuff accomplished. When I do, it's like amazing. But I really applaud people that can, like, I am up at 6 and I'm ready to animate at 8 o'clock, whatever it is. Like, I am not that guy.
Sure.
And my, it's like almost like my, it's like revving an engine and it doesn't get started until later today, which kind of fucks up my, you know, work-life balance, because then it means I'm going to be going to work, you know, being at work much later.
Sure.
Especially if we're in overtime. Mm-hmm. So typically I'll like leave. I like leave a lot. Like I'll just go for a walk. I'll go take a drive. I'll come home, eat dinner with the family, and then go back or whatever it is just to get the hell out of the office.
But, sure.
It's really not possible.
Yeah.
Gotcha. I come out here and I hide.
Yeah, yeah.
Lock the door.
Cool. So with that said, since now you have like a lot of experience in the industry, what advice would you give to like students or artists, like, you know, in their beginning stages of their career, or even now, like, like, what is something to look out for within the industry, and, you know, how to be a successful artist, whatever success means to them, I guess. But yeah, like, any insightful tips about the industry?
Yeah, like one thing that I always sort of kept in mind, and I think it's really helpful, is that no opportunity is too small. And like, don't, like, I wouldn't necessarily hold out for dream job, right? Like,
right.
Everyone's path is different, and whatever opportunity comes your way, kind of take it.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to meet so many people, because that network will just, it's just blossoming now, right?
Right.
And it's just going to continue to grow and grow the more, you know, you're a part of that community in the industry. So I would say, yeah, like, don't, like, take any opportunity you can, and try to run with it. And then I also think, just kind of piggybacking on that, is like, I feel like if your energy is all, this is sort of hokey, but like, if your energy is poured into one single thing and you're really wanting to do it, like, you really want to be an animator, you're going to manifest that in some way. I think you're going to make it happen in some capacity.
Mm-hmm.
So like, the effort put in will be rewarded, I think. And like, industry advice specifically, I think that there's this, the vogues that come in and out, like, you know, whether you're looking for like, how much experience you're looking for in a reel, or if you're willing to take a chance on somebody.
Mm-hmm.
I think knowing who you're applying to really helps.
Mm-hmm.
And tailoring your reel to that company.
Mm-hmm.
Understanding what other reels are you're going to be up against at that point. So like, looking at professional reels and saying, you know, I'm not just up against my classmates. I'm not just up against, you know, my next door neighbor. I'm up against these guys that have worked in the industry for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
I think Snow said something similar, was like, you need to understand who your field is, you know? And you get binocular vision sometimes, where you're only looking at the people around you. And the student reels that are out there, and you're failing to see the movies that are being released, and then the professional reels that are out there, people looking for the same job as you.
Right. Gotcha. Yeah. I guess I would say, I don't know about a closing statement, but like, This is the question that is repeated for all the mentors of like, is there a way that specific that you would like to run your class? Because you know, this mentorship program is like really, it's very free flowing, and you can, you know, it really is up to the mentor and the mentee to kind of come up with the game plan and how you want to run it. So is there anything that, I don't know, do you envision like your class in a certain way, or like how would you like to run the class basically? It's just so kind
of. Yeah. I've gravitated towards this. Obviously we've all talked with its organic nature.
Mm-hmm.
I have, like I said, my fair share of the formality of brick and mortar schools, and even the formality of online classes now, where mm-hmm. it's, you know, you do this test, you have this many weeks. Like, I don't know. Like if you're paying, you know, an instructor or a mentor to instruct you, then it should be tailored to your own personal goal.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say that I'm sure as many of my fellow colleagues are approaching it, it's like, whatever you want to learn, that's what we'll learn. You know,
mm-hmm.
If I'm seeing in the shots that people are showing something that there's, you know, well, maybe we should work on phrasing. Then mm-hmm. maybe the next class that we'll talk about phrasing.
Mm-hmm.
It really, what I like about this is how free flowing it is, and how it can, it's almost like a directed study in a group.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I like the most about my graduate degree, is when I was able to do directed studies with specific instructors. Mm-hmm. The difference with this is that there's several other people that could benefit from it. So mm-hmm. I think it's like a combination of what could be the best in a brick and mortar, and then outside of an actual curriculum.
Gotcha.
I think that sometimes curriculum leaves people behind.
For sure.
And it inhibits you from actually exploring what you're interested in. And that's what the whole point is, right?
Right. Yeah, no, I agree with you. So that said, I guess actually, if there are any questions that we missed, feel free to ask some questions if there that we missed, guys. I guess outside of animation, what do you like to do as a hobby? Because I know a lot of things that you like to do in terms of like things you upload on Instagram and whatnot. But for those who don't know, well, feel free to share.
Yeah, I love to do, so my pops was a woodworker. I love to do carving. Mm-hmm. If you check out my Instagram, you can see some of my carving. I still love to do illustration, but I love to do mixed media. So I like to combine, you know, like the woodworking aspect into, like, I just really love the textural aspect of illustration. So I love that kind of business. Oh, there you go.
Mm-hmm.
I like to have people be like, how did you make this?
Mm-hmm.
I love that type of illustration now. I mm-hmm. started off, if you dig low enough, like you can see, I started off as a realistic oil painter.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't really find interest in that anymore. I'm an avid baseball fan. I played, and to exercise or to scratch that itch, I've been playing softball for almost 20 years out here. So, I love it. And I've played guitar for 25 years. Play banjo. I love indie music and folk. I love it all. So I love the immediacy of music. I think that's what I gravitated towards, because I drawing as a kid, everything was so labor intensive, because I would do these really meticulous graphite drawings, like that would look like these oil paintings.
Sure.
But graphite. And I was like, I think I picked up guitar. I love music, obviously,
mm-hmm.
but I picked up the guitar because it was like, oh man, that's immediate gratification.
It's right, right, right.
You can just create something, and it's like it fulfills your creative needs right there.
Sure. Let's see. Someone asked in the chat a sec. When critiquing, do you rely more on like verbal instruction or draw overs or something else?
Well, I could probably do it all.
Mm-hmm.
I you know, I don't know if I prefer it. It's kind of like what the student would want. If I could get up and act it, then that's cool.
Sure.
If it's super specific, then maybe drawing it works. I don't see the need of drawing something just to show you that I can draw something.
For sure.
You know?
Yeah, yeah.
We we all know that that exists out there. So,
for sure.
Like if, however I can most effectively communicate the note, mm-hmm. that's what I'll do.
For
and
sure.
However you would like to receive it. If you like, if I can't describe an eye shape with like, you know, manipulating my fingers and my own eyeballs, then I'll probably draw it, you know?
Yeah, 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 that makes sense. And someone also asked about like, could you talk about your first experience in animation? And I think to expand on that question is like, these are the questions I've also asked to other mentors, like knowing what you know now, and especially how you approached your first experience in animation, what is an advice that you would give to your younger self?
Wow. I would say, what would I say? Man. That's a really tough question.
It's a loaded question.
It's, yeah, right? What would I say to myself back then that I know now?
I mean, you can talk about your first experience, like when you first got into industry first and then...
Yeah, well, I mean, I think what I suffered from was sort of the advice that I gave a little earlier was that I ended up being a little myopic in what I was looking at. Like I looked at around, you know, my fellow classmates, even in my grad degree, you know, and I was older, obviously. Mm-hmm. Well, I was in my 20s. I'm not that old. Mm-hmm. Now. But like different than an undergrad. But I would look at the people around me and say, well, I think I'm doing okay because where I fit in with this group. Not really like looking at the professional reels and stuff.
Sure.
I guess maybe understanding... working in different animation styles early on, so nothing really terrified me.
Sure.
Because when I entered the industry, everything sort of terrified me because I was so inexperienced.
Sure.
So like really not being shy when there's no stakes. Because as a student, the stakes are much lower because you have the time and you're not up against severe deadlines and your livelihood isn't really... affected by this quite yet. So you can take some more risks, and I'd say like, yeah, take risks, explore more, don't limit yourself, and I think maybe I approached that because I was so scared of not getting a job.
Sure.
I really wanted to make a reel that that studios would like, and I think maybe I missed out on telling stories that I wanted to tell, or trying different shots that I should have tried, or you know,
for sure. I think that could wrap it up. So I don't know, do you have any like closing statements? I don't know, this can be your moment of just saying whatever you want.
No. Yeah, I'm looking forward to this. I think it's really going to be a real fun experiment for me. I think all of us coming in really, you know, Sean mentioned this and it seemed really like a fun opportunity to instruct and change the sort of paradigm of mentor-mentee. And I'm really interested in seeing what this experiment does, like how far we can stretch it and working in a curriculum free program. I think it's going to be really fun.
Sweet. Awesome. All right, so thanks everyone for joining the stream. Make sure to check the website for enrollment dates. It'll open in August, so if you want to sign up with Michael, just make sure you sign up for the waitlist. So all right, with that said, we'll end the stream here. All right, thanks guys.
Thank you.